Omar. I'm a food writer and cookbook author, and a former market manager at the Union Square Free Market just outside. When you work at the farmer's market, you learn a lot of things about a lot of people in the food industry. And one of the not-so-secret things I learned early on was that a chef named Michael Anthony was working with the owners of a farm called Norwich Meadows to commission custom-grown produce. Little-known heirloom varietals of all sorts of gorgeous vegetables that would soon show up on the menu at his restaurant, Gramercy Tavern. I guess it shouldn't have been a surprise, given Gramercy Tavern's reputation and the fact that Mike had just come from running the show at Blue Hill at Stone Barns, but at the time, I did not know his entire professional resume, and I was mightily impressed with the level of care that he was putting into getting his produce. A few years later, I interviewed Mike for a story about garlic, because in typical Mike Anthony fashion, he had enlisted the help of a farmer in upstate New York to custom grow a unique breed of garlic that his great-grandfather brought to America from Italy in 1908. What could have been a 20-minute phone call turned into an hour-long conversation about everything from immigration patterns to crop rotation to cooking techniques, all delivered in the most thoughtful and articulate fashion. And again, I was struck by his dedication to each and every ingredient that made its way into his kitchen, no matter how small. So it's only natural that with this new book, Mike should turn his full attention to vegetables in all of their glory. Written in conjunction with Dorothy Kalins, a founding editor of Savor and longtime friend of Mike and Danny's, the book encourages home cooks to find inspiration in the wide and wonderful world of vegetables. And it's a beautiful book, organized by vegetables A to Z, with gorgeous photos and hand-drawn illustrations by Mindy Dubin, Mike's wife, as well as intricate 19th century French botanical prints. It's also a practical book. The recipes are designed for home cooks to actually understand, while introducing them to some new ingredients and techniques they may not have previously considered. It's a book that reflects a growing and welcome shift in our collective attitude about what it means to eat well. It's not a vegetarian book, per se. Meat and seafood find their way into some recipes. And as Mike says, cooking with vegetables for him is not a political act. It's an enlightened way of thinking. That's an honorable sentiment, and hopefully one more people will learn to share as a result of this book. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce the men you're here to see. Danny Meyer, the CEO of Union Square Hospitality Group and the founder of Shake Shack, and Michael Anthony, executive chef of Gramercy Tavern and Untitled at the Whitney.
All right, guys, first of all, thank you all for coming out the Monday after Thanksgiving. Always an easy day thinking about what you want to eat, right? And I guess vegetables are exactly what I might be thinking about today after too much turkey in every single guise imaginable.
We had a very vegetable-forward Thanksgiving meal, I have to say.
I would hope you did this year. If not this year, when? Listen, seriously, it's really nice of all of you guys to come out. This is a fantastic cookbook, and when you walk the cookbook section of Barnes & Noble, I guess it would be a natural thing to ask yourself, does the world really need another cookbook? And if so, what should it be? And Mike, you came up with this awesome idea.
I was not alone. We had an amazing team assembled for the Gramercy Tavern cookbook. Dorothy Kalins, the co-author, is here. And as we were finishing up, I think we might have actually been celebrating the published date of the Gramercy Tavern cookbook, and no sooner the appetizers hadn't even hit the table when we started talking about, we left a lot of great ideas out there. The Gramercy Tavern cookbook being about the heart and soul of Gramercy Tavern, and V is for vegetables, it takes a little turn. It's a bit more of my particular fascination with cooking vegetables and really distinctly how I like to cook them at home. So cooking for Gabby, Colette, and Addie, my daughters, as well as cooking with Mindy, my wife, and our friends. We took a look at how not simply distinctively we cook with vegetables at the restaurant, but how that impacts the way we like to eat at home. It's connected because I think for those of us who work in restaurants and for those of us who just simply love to cook and eat, the dishes that we come up with that are really inspired by the way we eat at home are the most powerful. When we kind of have the courage to focus on, whether it's looking back in some of the recipes in the book, I use nostalgia as a source of inspiration, which rarely happens at the restaurant.
What would be an example of that?
Well, so it's interesting. It was a fascinating discovery, looking back at my maternal grandmother's a recipe card that she left my mom, tattered and torn and splattered, bent around the edges. It was called pot pie. And I remember the dish as a kid, not very fondly, to be honest. But pot pie, okay, I know what pot pie is, but my mom's family is from Indianapolis. They came through Pennsylvania. I did a little research, asked a lot of questions of aunts and uncles. Pot pie refers to a potato dumpling dish by the Pennsylvania Dutch. I always thought, well, how is that that we have folks from Holland in our family? Not from Holland, but from Germany. And so there was a certain exploration that went into this recipe. I decided rather than to make these very heavy, dense potato dumplings that my grandfather, who worked on a railroad, knew all his life, I decided to treat them more like a gnocchi. I gave them a little elegance, a little fluff, and then made the same rich chicken stock and folded a bunch of vegetables in the way we would cook at home in one big pot. And Dorothy, how was it? It turned out pretty good.
Speaking of Dorothy, I understand you had an interesting process to write this book, the actual writing of the book and the recipes and the whole design of the book. How did you and Dorothy do that?
Well, first, I should say thank you to Roger, her husband, because they both allowed us to turn their apartment upside down, and it really became a photo studio and test kitchen over the period of a year where we set out to cook every single dish. We shot it both process and right up to finished dish during the time I would be cooking and prepping and chopping with an assistant in the kitchen. We shot profiles of each of the vegetables on their dining room table in natural sunlight. Moore McAvoy was the remarkable photographer. And we asked our favorite farmers and friends to pull plants, roots, stems, leaves, berries intact, to capture a look at what these plants really look like, how we rarely see them. So we wanted these profiles of plants, and they found their way onto the dining room table. They were photographed, and then the diligent photographer, Maura McAvoy, would get right in over my shoulder and shoot, flames included. Don Morris, even the graphic designer, was in the kitchen, the recipe tester at his side, leaning in, and let me tell you, we know it's not easy being the chef, period, right? You're putting your reputation on the line, whether you're in a restaurant or at home. It's not easy being the cook, but with a whole studio full of chefs all commenting on the process, there were a lot. It took a lot of flexibility.
You're getting me a little nervous right now, because the thing that I love most about this book is that it seems like these are really easy recipes to cook, and now you're telling me you have a whole army of chefs in the kitchen with you.
Only,
I only have that at home.
Well, only commenting about
comment.
And honestly, kind of catching the moments that, as a trained chef, that I would, you know, tend to cut something or manipulate something in a chef-y way, it was like there was a red card that came out. Wait a second, no one's going to do it like that. So there was this safety net of, let's be real here. Let's talk about how people are really going to cook at home. And so for that, you know, it took a little patience on only my part. For you all, you benefit from the product of our work together.
That actually reminds me of when Michael Romano and I collaborated on the first Union Square Cafe cookbook in 94, I guess it was, Michael's nickname for me, he was a great chef, is a great chef, but his nickname for me was the kitchen creep one, because my job was to constantly say to the chef, I don't get it. What do you mean? What do you mean cook till it's, you know, barely sweating? Till you're barely sweating? You know? And so my job was to be that voice. But now I understand, because when you said you had an army of chefs in the kitchen, how did you and Dorothy write together?
Well, most of those days came with us sitting in front of her computer, talking through these stories. Sometimes the stories would just roll. They came from experiences of when I first encountered a vegetable. I tried to really kind of look back. As a kid, I was a terrible eater. And in some ways, I wanted to be sympathetic for people who find the subject of vegetables either out of being slightly unfamiliar, that they find them intimidating, or really from an experienced cook's perspective of, oh, I know that if I have several vegetables here, it's going to take me a while to peel these and get through them. So I wanted to, you know, to be able to relate. And I tried to frequently take that tone of voice of, I understand that this might feel intimidating, but let's take a look at some of these pictures, or let me explain about what happened to me, what made me fall in love with eating these vegetables. Dorothy, being the great storyteller that she is, would ask just the right question at just the right time, and it would allow those stories to flow. Dorothy did another amazing thing, is that this book is not a mantra of how you should eat. It's an invitation to eating well and enjoying the idea of eating fresh foods and discovering that cooking them doesn't have to be a chore, doesn't have to be hours and hours of work. We call that process unzipping vegetables. It's relatively surprising and relatively easy how fast you can bridge that gap from seeing a pile of even dirty vegetables right out of the green market, hours out of the ground, to clean, washed, and in the pan, making you salivate of, oh, dinner's really going to be delicious.
If you think about all the different kinds of food that you encounter at the Gramercy Tavern Kitchen, or at Untitled at the Whitney, and now you put yourself in the shoes of being a home cook, what do you think is the most intimidating type of food for the home cook relative to what you guys do in the kitchen?
Well,
is it fish? Is it vegetables? Is it desserts?
We left fish and meat for a story for another day.
Oh, there's another cookbook coming.
We did have a celebration after this, the release of this book, we'll see. But no, I really thought that vegetables were the most immediate of stories. When we think about how we cook meals and turn an ordinary day into a celebration, it could be a normal work day in the middle of a week, a silly Monday night, and the idea of going home and cooking something doesn't have to be luxurious, doesn't have to be laborious, but the looking at a vegetable with that quality, that kid-like quality of, I'm going to make a discovery tonight, or I'm just simply going to treat myself to something fresh and delicious. The exploration of, I'm going to try to cook this dinner a little different, thinking of the proportion of ingredients that we use, and really exploring this idea that eating well doesn't always have to be an expensive proposition. That's the very first thing we all hear when we talk about eating well. Oh, sure, as long as you're willing to spend enough money. But the reality of it is, this book explores this idea of eating well is really a question of proportion. It's a bit of prioritization. It doesn't happen with just a snap. It does take a small investment, but that investment can you know, pay off in huge dividends by being together in the kitchen. If you're cooking for kids, part of the deal is having them pick what you're going to eat and maybe peel what you're going to eat, and that buy-in it helps me along the way.
How many different vegetables are featured in this book?
Well, there are over 125 different recipes, and each letter signifies a chapter. How many? 61 exactly, thank you. But each chapter is different, and we did not let the book get too serious. We hit two and we were like, I don't know, what would you name? I see Marco scratching his head. We said, fine, if we can't find one that really stands out for all of us, then Quince is fair game, and we're going to go for it. I won't even begin to tell you how we got to choosing extra virgin olive oil for X, but I'll ask you, if you have another suggestion, I'm all ears. So we didn't want it to make the book overly serious, and I will say again, this is in a large part thanks to Dorothy, that the book did not turn into a mantra. Again, this is not warning people that if you don't eat your vegetables, you're going to hell. It's all about the idea of treating yourself to the pleasures of eating great food, that vegetables act as a gateway into the distinctive foods that we can eat.
One thing I just want to comment, I'm just going to let everyone know here that soon you're going to get a chance to ask your questions to Mike, and he's really excited to hear those. And you're going to see me leaving because I'm going to celebrate my mom's 81st birthday at Union Square Cafe, which now has 12 dinner services left before we close, which I'm very bittersweet about. But I'm thinking back to 30 years ago when Union Square Cafe opened. And believe it or not, even though the Green Market was definitely extant at that time, it was 2 days a week, it was every Wednesday and Saturday, no Mondays, no Fridays. And if you went to a restaurant in New York City, the finest restaurants all start with a little lager eel, all of them. And the idea of a vegetable was that every one of those fancy restaurants had its own house vegetable mix, which were generally something sauteed out of season. Excuse me, something out of season, comma, sauteed. And the exact same, I knew there were editors in the crowd. And the exact same spoonful would go on every single dish. So one kind of vegetable mix, carrots, broccoli, string beans, and diced potatoes, and that would go with the fish, that would go with the veal chop, that would go with, the chicken, whatever you were serving. And it was kind of a new thing for a restaurant like Union Square Cafe to pick a different vegetable as a side accompaniment to every dish on the menu. And then furthermore, to change that vegetable according to what the season was. And I remember when you first came to Gramercy Tavern, which is now 10 years, almost 10 years ago, you got to the point where you were not only taking that, but you were changing the vegetable every single day so we could know exactly what the season was. And then I'll never forget when your vegetable tasting menu, the next thing you did that I thought was fascinating was exactly what's the story in this book, which is that not all of the menu items on the vegetable tasting menu are vegetarian. And I thought that was kind of, excuse the expression, ballsy of you.
Well, the idea is that, that way of eating is not really, has nothing to do with self-deprivation. It has everything to do with pleasure. And the idea that those vegetables really say something distinctive about eating here. When we cook in another place, especially when we travel to another place, we remember those meals that that are connected, culturally connected physically to that particular place. So, it's after all these travels and all of the wonderful places that we've eaten and some that we've eaten together in, it kind of raises that question, but what is it about eating here? Every time I come home to New York, I feel this intense sense of pride, and it's an amazing quality that we have here. And so I always ask that question, well, what is it about eating here that can communicate that sense of pride and pleasure?
So in a certain sense, when you say it's not a mantra, and you kind of go, well, a typical restaurant menu doesn't have a section called carnivore's tasting menu, right? And yet all of those meat-forward or protein-forward dishes are generally accompanied by some type of vegetable. So what you're basically saying is, this is not going to be a vegetarian menu. This is going to be a vegetable-forward menu. And sometimes those vegetables are going to be accompanied by some type of meat. Now, is that to increase the pleasure or just to make sure you get your protein, or are you doing that?
Well, it's just because they taste great together. Those things are delicious partners. They belong on the plate in some way, shape, or form, and we like eating them together. It's not an excuse for throwing a little bacon in every vegetable because that tastes great, but it's about thinking carefully. Just, you know, the idea of that transition of that you described at Union Square about serving something that belongs with each dish. It has meaning. I think this is just the clear evolution of the way we as American cooks and enthusiastic eaters all over have kind of naturally come a full circle. This book kind of feels quite natural and normal that we'd be talking about this subject now. We've come a long way where we're interested in some of the most basic techniques. If you ask cooks around 10 years ago what aspect of cooking they're most interested in, you might have heard butchery and charcuterie. I think now you ask that question and you might hear something like fermentation and pickling. So these are subjects that are naturally kind of rising to the surface given the fact that we have access to great food, we're paying more attention to the things we eat. We are thinking a little bit more carefully about what exactly we're putting in our bodies, but above all, we just want to eat well and live well. That's what's driving this story.
So I have one last question before you guys get to ask Mike your questions, and that is, when I think about this book, should I be thinking about getting great ideas for vegetables to put in the middle of the table to accompany my carnivore main course, or should I be thinking primarily of these recipes as being the main event?
The idea with this book is that these dishes were intended to really kind of occupy the spotlight. Some step up and steal the show. If you like eating them next to your meat dishes, then great. We didn't insist that they couldn't live side by side with fish and meat. You'll find some of those recipes in the book. But above all, we wanted to say that sometimes we just feel like exploring a dish that it's not without meat. It's just all about the vegetables that it's made of.
All right, I lied. One last question. Which one of these recipes did you cook for Thanksgiving?
I have to say, I didn't cook any of them. But we did about, what's the number? 6 of them for the family. My mother-in-law was responsible for making them all. So yeah, the book held out with Thanksgiving this year.
All right, well, in that case, of the 6 dishes that your beautiful mother-in-law cooked, which one do you want to cook next year?
I'll say that I thought the carrots came out great.
You have to do a little doctoring.
A little doctoring, but it was dynamite. The carrots.
All right. Have fun, you guys. Mike.
Up for some of your questions. Don't be shy. There is a microphone around, or for those of you who end up talking loud on a regular basis. Anybody?
I guess I know. You spoke a lot about your connection to your vegetable dishes and your food through your family and your experiences. You have 3 children, you mentioned. I introduce cooking to my students in a way that has to hopefully be enjoyed by everybody. How do you introduce new vegetables, I guess, to your children, and do they always like it?
I'll start by answering the last question. Do they always like it? No, we are all in this together. There are no secrets. There's no easy paths. It's tough. I mean, kids or adults, like we have so many psychological connections to the foods that we eat. And I mentioned that sometimes I think it's a little harder to bridge that gap of seeing, say, a gnarly, you know, knobby celery root or sunchoke and like clicking and saying, ooh, in instantly seeing them as, you know, caramelized and steamy and a, you know, a delicious meal. So there seems to be a wider gap between that and the other foods that we immediately associate with deliciousness. The way I try to get them to eat it is really to get them involved, probably the same way you do with your class. It's about opening some windows. It's not really, first of all, I will admit that there is nothing I haven't tried. I am willing to resort to anything and everything. But when I maintain my composure, the reality of it is just simply introducing them to some new shapes and new sizes and new flavors. It's kind of like we spend a lot of time with kids from PS41, right around the corner, sorry, that way. I try to, whenever we're doing a demo, I'll take some whole examples of the vegetables that we cook, and I hand it a large yellow cauliflower to a little guy, and he just picked it up and said, "I love these things." It was that sense of fascination with like the weight of a vegetable or the shape or the color. And I think it's kind of exciting that as adults, you know, on a normal day, you might be able to treat yourself to that childlike fascination of cooking vegetables. And then I think it's participation. As long as it can last and don't go into it with any preconceived notions of how long it will last. I am lucky because I get a box of vegetables through a CSA. It's delivered to our home, which is, I find, kind of amazing. So every Friday we pull something out of that box and go through that routine of, look at this thing. Can you imagine what this is? Part of the book was also written out of a response. Mindy's friends and my wife's friends would post every week a picture of vegetables that came out of their CSA basket with the question of, can anyone tell me what this is? And I would wait and I would see, you know, people chiming in and I would say, I don't know, it's not garlic. And so part of it was just simply helping folks out to, you know, whether you like taking a walk through the grain market or you really are intentfully trying to, you know, eat something new, we just don't grow up, generally speaking, with all of these things. There are a lot of forgotten vegetables that are now introduced and readily available and actually grow really well. So I wanted to be able to help to name these things and say their names out loud so that people would feel just a little more comfortable enjoying them.